Good evening. I'm Jennifer Rabin, have the great privilege of being the president of the extraordinary institution Hunter College and part of this wonderful public policy institution at Roosevelt House. Tonight we have a little bit of a bittersweet evening because our wonderful moderator, Dr. Jonathan Fanton, who is our interim director of the Roosevelt House Public Policy Institute, who has taken us to such great heights, and so many of you here have enjoyed these extraordinary programs and the intellectual life that Dr. Fanton has brought to the East Side, will join me in thanking him as he makes plans to depart for an extraordinary opportunity in becoming the head of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences in Boston. So when Jonathan, when we lured Jonathan to help us envision Roosevelt House 5 years ago for 6 months, I told him some amazing opportunity is going to come along, and when it does, we understand you have to take it, and then we just kept playing along. So it's been an extraordinary 5 years. This has been just a pleasure for all of us involved with being part of Jonathan's team in creating a public policy institute of great vision, of great quality, and perhaps most importantly, teaching the next generation about great values and about public citizenship. So to one of the great public citizens, please join me in thanking Jonathan Fanton. And I wanted to be here to raise a virtual glass to my dear friend, Dick Ravitch, who has been an inspiration and a mentor to me, another person who understands the incredible value of both public leadership and public management. We're very lucky that Dick is on our Roosevelt House Advisory Board. And Dick will talk tonight about the incredible contributions he has made to public life, his intelligence, his stamina, and his courage in standing up for his principles as he's been a great leader in New York City and New York State. But Dick's success is actually no surprise to us at Hunter College because, after all, his mother is a Hunter graduate. And they're actually, as famous as Dick is, even his mother was a little bit famous because in May 1925, the New York Times reported that the then Hunter girls went up to Lewisham Stadium, which has now been demolished at City College, for a production of Antigone, which was played by one Sylvia Lerner. And Sylvia had as her co-star in the show one Sylvia Ravitch, her friend. So Sylvia Ravitch introduced Sylvia Lerner to her brother, and the rest is history. So from Greek tragedy to today, Dick's incredible career, his leadership in the MTA, but perhaps most importantly, his deep understanding of economic and fiscal policies and the danger that we all face when governments don't pay attention. And Dick, I think it's the perfect place to have a celebration of this extraordinary memoir and of your advice and your vision to the future, because this was, of course, the place where literally the day after FDR was elected, he went upstairs and gave his first radio address in 1930 to over the radio to the country to ask them for patience and perseverance for his vision for an economic recovery. And this is where that economic recovery was first planned to get us out of the Depression. And that was an incredible influence, and in your own way, you have had this extraordinary influence in the way we approach affordable housing, transportation, and the management of our budget. There's so much that you've done that you leave us as a legacy that affects the health of our city and of our state, and I am just deeply grateful that you've put your wisdom, your vision, your experiences into this wonderful book so that it will be available for our students to learn what a great public servant is. It is a wonderful pleasure for me to introduce Dick Ravitch, a great treasure in New York State. Thank you, Dick. Give him a kiss.
Why not? Thank you, Jennifer. It is a pleasure to be here. when one publishes a book, one gets invited at least for a limited period of time to talk about it. But to me, the opportunity to talk about it in a place where ideas are more important per se than a book itself is a meaningful opportunity. And I'm going to tell you all that the reasons why I wrote this book. In part, there was always inevitably a little bit of ego involved, but I would not have undertaken this Sisyphean task if I didn't have something I was trying to convey and convey seriously. And that was a concern that our politics in New York and in this country at this point in time were not addressing the fundamental domestic problem in this society. And I worry about it. I worry about it because we have 13 grandchildren, and unless things change, they're going to have to pay a hell of a lot of money for things that I got the benefit of. And that's what I want to talk about a little bit today before Jonathan cross-examines me. Politics has become a dirty word in the language of so many people in this country, it isn't funny. There are distinguished journalists who use the word politics in almost persistently in a pejorative connotation. And I've never quite understood that since I know the only way you can change things in a democracy is through politics, which is why I began the book with a quote from Plato that says, if you're not prepared to engage in politics, you better get used to the fact that you're going to be governed by inferior people. And I was flabbergasted that the media gives more space to a state legislator who cuts up his girlfriend with a broken bottle than they did to the fact that the state of New York had a deficit of $9 or $10 billion. And I was increasingly struck by the fact that there was a total disconnect between what was happening at the federal level and what was happening at the state level, and almost as compelling a disconnect between what was happening at a state level and what's happening at the local government level in almost every jurisdiction. So when I left a year and a half in Albany, which was probably the least productive time in my life, I nonetheless acquired a great deal of interest in this subject and was curious whether other states had similar problems. And above all, I couldn't understand when I learned that most states indeed faced comparable issues. I couldn't understand why nobody seemed to have learned the lessons from the New York experience in 1975. And there isn't time to go into the whole story, and there's a chapter of the book devoted to it. And it's always been amazing to me that more hasn't been written about it. But at the risk of oversimplifying it, I have to tell you, New York City came perilously close to having to file bankruptcy because for the previous 8 years, it had covered its deficits by borrowing money. And every year it borrowed enough money to pay back the loan that they'd made the year before and enough to cover their deficit. And finally, in May of 1975, the banks got very, very concerned, I think, about a lot of things, including their potential liability under the fraud provisions of the securities law. And they told Governor Carey one day at 2:30 on May 2nd, actually, because I was the only other person in the room, that they would no longer underwrite the notes and bonds of the city of New York. Now, every state in the United States has either a constitutional or statutory requirement to balance its budget. And that, if you ask anybody at Treasury or in the Federal Reserve or the National Governors Association and the National Association of State Budget Directors, they'll tell you states have to have balanced budgets. Well, I'll tell you three things about that. Number one, under the New York Constitution, the governor's got to introduce a balanced budget, but there is no requirement that the state end up with a balanced budget. Number two, revenue's not a defined term. So that states and cities have increasingly been using the proceeds of asset sales and borrowings to balance their budget, which by definition is not a sustainable course. Let me give you a few illustrations. Arizona sold its state capital, leased it back, of course, used the proceeds of the sale to balance its operating budget. Chicago sold 75 years of parking revenue, used the proceeds to balance Dick Daley's last budget, and left the city of Chicago with no parking meters and no parking revenue. New York State sold Attica Prison for $200 million, to a public benefit corporation of its own creation, and has since paid $400 million of interest in order to have used the sale proceeds to balance its budget some years ago. The governor of California proudly proclaims that they've overwhelmed and overcome the fiscal crisis in California. At the same time, the trustees of the teachers' retirement system have made it very clear in writing that the system is underfunded by $200 billion. So when you really examine what's happening around the country, you realize, and any oversimplification can be unfair, you really recognize the fact that all of the political incentives are to kick the can down the road. No politician wants to tax or cut if they can borrow or sell an asset. And there are umpteen billions of dollars of debt overhanging, not for capital investment purposes, but for the purposes of relieving the deficits in operating budgets. And there is a profound ignorance, unwillingness on the part of many, many people to face up to that reality. Now, I want to say a couple of other things about this, because I think it's so important. The efforts to address the federal budget deficit, whatever your politics are, you can't deny the fact that there is not an unlimited capacity on the part of the federal government to borrow money. So whether you don't have to believe in Paul Ryan's budget, but you have to recognize that there has to be some restraint exercised. And most of those cuts are going to occur in the discretionary portion of the federal budget. The non-military discretionary portion of the federal budget provides for $650 billion to the states in the United States. States have about 30%, close to 30% of what states spend comes from federal sources. When that is cut, it has been the last 2 years. It's going to be this year. We don't know the specifics yet. It's going to have a significant impact on what states can do. At the same time, they live with mandates. They live with contractual obligations, occasionally constitutional obligations, to pay pensions to people who worked for them for 20 years. They have obligations to pay interest on the money that they borrowed. They have obligations to fund, although there's some flexibility as to how and to what extent they do it, but they have an every state has a Medicaid program. And there are social needs that vary from jurisdiction to jurisdiction that our society has essentially committed itself to address in a serious fashion. And therefore, those obligations, particularly those that are mandated by contract or law, result in a crowding out of those things which are deferrable, which are the investments in the future. Rutgers University published a study in which they said that the states of the United States spent $650 million less on pre-K education last year than they did the year before. And in my book, if you want to disinvest in the future of the United States, I can't think of a better way of doing it than to stop to cut back on pre-K education. Infrastructure investment. Every organization, every department of transportation from state to state has given our governments a grade of at best D for keeping up with an appropriate level of reinvestment in our physical infrastructure. And therefore, when you look at just look at the Census Bureau projections, which show that our population is going to go up by 40 or 50 million people in the next 30 years, and that most of the population will be concentrated in our major urban centers. And ask yourself, and you don't have to quantify it with precision, but ask yourself, what kind of investment are we going to need in our public transportation, in our educational institutions, in order to be able to provide a civil life for the people who are going to live in these cities? I don't think I've overstated any of the facts. I think there are people who say, maybe the dog will talk. Maybe we'll have a rapid inflation that will bail out a lot of people. That, of course, will create a whole other set of problems. There's a big debate over whether or not funding these defined benefit pension plans is meaningful or not. Then the truth of the matter is that by any sensible, rational, conservative projection, these funds are underfunded by trillions and trillions of dollars. And a lot of people, in order, again, to be able to kick the can down the road, use discount rates to compute the adequacy of their pension systems that are absurdly high, 7.5%. If any of you, as I'm sure many of you did, as I did, started putting money away for your kids' education, I don't think you ever assumed that you were going to earn that amount of money annually. And nor, if you had done it properly, could you have done that calculation just on the basis of what you thought you might earn on your assets. You also have to value your liabilities. And being the grandfather of 13 people, I can tell you I never would have dreamed that tuition would be what it is today. So I want to wind this up so we can get to the questions, which are more interesting, by saying that I'm nonetheless an optimist, and I'll tell you why. Because as I think about the 80 years that I've lived, and I think about the problems that this society has solved, whether it was 150 years of racial segregation, whether it was World War II, a depression, competition with the Soviet Union, and the pride I had in the fact that this society, during the period when America's hegemony was unquestioned in the world and our prosperity seemed to be permanent and perpetual, that we made a lot of promises to a lot of people in order to make sure they had a better life. Health care for the elderly, and now, thank God, for everyone. I regret the fact, however, that we didn't pay enough attention as to whether we had the resources to meet all those obligations. And that's the central domestic issue in the future. And the reason I'm optimistic that it's going to get solved is because I think increasingly young people are going to recognize that they're going to pay the price. And I think, and I hope, that they're going to engage in politics in a way that other generations were inspired to go into politics in order to make the world a better place. And I think that they will do that, and when they do, we'll begin to elect better people, smarter people. Maybe, hopefully, we will begin to diminish the influence of money in electoral politics in the United States. I think there's a growing movement to do that through amendments to the Constitution. And therefore, I think people have to be educated to understand the severity of the problems we face and appreciate the fact that they're not going to get solved except through the political process. Having said probably more than I should, I'll stop at this point and turn it over to Jonathan, and I thank you all for coming.
Well, thank you, Dick. That is a wonderful warm-up and preview of a really terrific book. So much to do, a full life of business politics and confronting financial crises. Dick will be signing books upstairs after our event tonight. So here's the plan. He and I will talk for about half an hour or so, and then we'll open it up for questions from the audience, and we'll be done promptly at 7:20. So we are in the homes of Eleanor and Franklin Roosevelt and Sarah. You had a lunch in 1952 with Eleanor Roosevelt. What surprised you about her? And as you were growing up, what did you think about Eleanor and Franklin?
Well, I grew up in a family that worshiped Roosevelt. And my parents sent me to a school on 123rd Street and Morningside Drive, and where even in the 1930s, everybody had to do community service. That was part of the obligations of the students. And when I arrived at Columbia University in 1952 after transferring from Oberlin, I not only had a spectacular education, but I already was interested in politics, and I ended up co-chairing the Students for Stevenson endeavor. Remember, the president of Columbia was none other than Dwight Eisenhower. And Students for Stevenson was not exactly a raucous crowd. It was during the McCarthy era, and kids didn't get involved in politics as much as they hopefully do today. But we wrote Mrs. Roosevelt a letter asking her if she would speak at the Students for Stevenson rally at Columbia. And to my surprise, I got a letter back saying that she would, and I should call her secretary at the following number, which I did. And for reasons I'm not sure how I had the nerve to do this, we had agreed that she'd come to Columbia at 2 o'clock one afternoon, and I said, might I take her to lunch? And the secretary said she'd be delighted. So, well, I was so thrilled. I didn't let the co-chairman in on this so I could have lunch with her. And I got home and I said to my mother, where do I take Eleanor Roosevelt to lunch? And she gave me the name of a little French restaurant in the 60s, because Mrs. Roosevelt lived at 62nd Street, I think at the time. Am I correct, Bill? And I borrowed my mother's car because I couldn't see running around hailing taxis. And I picked Mrs. Roosevelt up, and we went to the restaurant. I realized I hadn't thought about, what am I going to do about the car? And I wasn't about to find a garage. So I double-parked the car, quite prepared to have it towed away and ticketed. But there was a doorman in the adjoining building who intuited my dilemma and said, don't worry, kid, I'll take care of it. And I had this lunch with this extraordinary woman. And who obviously had no obligation whatsoever to spend time with me, but she was passionately interested in young people. and in the UN and peace in the world and civil rights. And she talked to me about her convictions, and it was a very, very moving experience. I then drove up to Columbia, where she gave a speech to what was embarrassingly a very small crowd. This time my car did get ticketed, but it was not an expenditure I was unhappy about.
Well, I asked that question so you will know that this is not just a book about fiscal crises. There's a lot of Dick Ravitch in this book, and that's one of the real joys of reading this book. So that's just one of many stories. You write early on in the book, in the past 60 years, I've done many things and found that I had the temperament to enjoy many different worlds, law, construction, real estate, labor, politics, and government. I relished negotiations in labor or politics that lasted late into the night. And in truth, I was competitive and easily bored. Public life offered contests and excitement on a scale the private sector could rarely match. Above all, it offered a real sense of purpose. So if public life is number one in your hit parade of enjoyable and meaningful things, what would be the second or third most enjoyable of your many occupations, and what do you do for fun?
First and foremost is my family. I'm blessed to have a spectacular family and 13 grandchildren that I adore. So public service is subordinate to that. I do have hobbies. I like to garden. I'm very eager, looking forward to Saturday to plant some tomatoes in the hopes that the weather doesn't get too cold again. And I work with wood, and I've made furniture and for our home now for, I guess, 40, 50 years.
You have been a generous mentor and role model to many people. And it's really amazing when you walk around the city with people come up on the street and thank him and recognize him. Who were your mentors growing up?
Intellectually, Lionel Trilling, Jack Barzin, Richard Hofstadter, David Truman. I had an extraordinary experience. They taught me, or at least all the political values or sensibilities that I have, I learned from them. I was very, very lucky to have done most of my public service when Hugh Gary was governor and Ed Koch were mayor, because they were both people, different as night is from day, but they were always totally supportive. They never told me who to hire. They never told me what to do. They were incredibly helpful. And whether you call them a mentor, but they were the people who were ultimately politically accountable and had to make the ultimate decisions about the things that I was involved in. And as I wrote this book and went back and read the New York Times for 40 years, or I had a clip for me, I really appreciated more than I ever had before how extraordinary they were. And I could tell so many stories.
Tell us a couple.
Well, let's see. Gary asked me to be chairman of the MTA. It was a total surprise. I was visiting I was on the board of Channel 13, and the president had asked me to set up a meeting with the governor because the state was cutting back subsidies of public television. And we're at the meeting, we get to the governor's office, and the governor motions for me to come into his office, but not the president of Channel 13. He says, I want you to become the chairman of the MTA. Well, I had a pretty good relationship with the governor at that point, having worked with him intensely during the fiscal crisis a few years earlier. And I said, Govy, you out of your cotton picking mind? I said, I ride the subways. You don't. I mean, they're in terrible, terrible shape. And he said, I won't see your friend until you say yes. Well, obviously, he did, and I promised him I'd think about it. And then he had Ed Koch call me, who importuned me to do it as well. And then the Speaker of the Assembly and the Majority Leader in the State Senate, and I, being obviously a public service junkie, I agreed to it. A week later, the governor and the mayor had a press conference in which they announced the fare would not go up. when I went to Albany a week after that for my confirmation, I asked one of the state senators on the relevant committee to ask me whether there were any circumstances under which I would raise the fare. And I said, and he said, Dick, I don't want to create a problem or make a news event. We're going to confirm you. I'm not going to ask. I said, damn it, ask me that question. So we did, and I said, of course. I'll raise the fare if I don't have enough money to run a safe subway system. That was a big headline. The governor's staff didn't talk to me for months. And a couple of nights later, the governor always had me stay at the mansion. Governor says to me, he says, thank God you bailed me out of that stupid comment I made the other day. I mean, that was Hugh Carey. Another Hugh Carey story. This is a great one. In 1978, he was challenged in the primary by Lieutenant Governor, whose name was Marion Krupczak, and he decided to try to relieve the ethnic advantage that she had by appointing somebody of Polish origin to be president of the Long Island Railroad, and he appointed a guy who was a World War II ace and had shot down a lot of Nazi planes, and a very nice guy. And as I got to know him after I became chairman, I realized he did not really have the ability to run the Long Island Railroad. I had to make a change, and I hired a headhunter and eventually met a guy who I thought would be a very good president of the Long Island Railroad. And after making those arrangements and about to fire Mr. Gabreski, I thought I owed the governor the courtesy of calling him, and I called him. And I told him that I was going to fire Gabreski and I was going to hire a guy by the name of Robin Wilson, and I wanted to bring him in to meet the governor. And and I said, but I do want you to know, governor, that I've got to pay him $105,000 a year. He said, that's more than I make. And I said, well, that's why I wanted to make sure you knew about it before you read about it in the paper. There was a moment of silence, and he said, I guess he had a better year than I did.
Yeah. Let's save Koch for a minute. You know, you were just talking about Kerry getting himself in trouble with something he said. You are pretty quick to speak your mind, fearless, some would say, and you once threatened to put President Reagan's face on the subway token.
I did.
Have you ever said anything in jest or with an edge that you had to retract or got you in trouble? Like that statement?
Let's see. Well, I do remember when I first went to Albany in 75, and I'd had no experience in dealing with the press before, and the UDC story was the number one New York State story all over the papers, and we were in Jack's restaurant, which is the hangout in Albany, and there were reporters and other people around, and a very distinguished former journalist, Linda Greenhouse, was then a relatively cub reporter, the Albany correspondent in the New York Times. She said to me, standing at the bar, what'd you really think of Nelson Rockefeller? And not knowing the difference between on the record or off the record, I said, he's a cross between Ponzi and Robin Hood. Well, that got into the press, and I got a call the next day from a law school professor who was a friend and a mentor, and he said, Dick, I want to remind you, you're still a young pisher, and he's vice president of the United States. So I was very embarrassed about that.
George Orwell's memoir, Homage to Catalonia, had an impact on you when you wrote in your book, and I quote, his book was the era's greatest caution against the notion that high ideals of the left or right could save people from having to engage in the messy work of coming to grips with opposing points of view in a democracy. So I infer from that some skepticism about ideology of all kinds. How would you describe your own political philosophy?
Well, I had to deal with rather mundane questions about money and how it gets raised and how it gets spent. There were underlying values about what a society's obligation were that had a lot to do with what you believed in. And you had a view about what a role was for people in government, and I thought particularly with some good advice from my counsel who's sitting over here, that my responsibility, my fiduciary obligation, was to get as much money as I could to solve the problems that I was in charge of solving. So that wasn't really ideological, but I thought my job was to petition all levels of government for money. And even though they were uncomfortable, often with it, they privately didn't mind at all. And I remember once I had to raise the fare very significantly to get the money we needed at the MTA, and I passed, or had the board of the MTA pass, two fare increases, one to take effect immediately and another to take effect, if I remember the date, on July 15th. Is that right, Steve? Approximately. And sort of dared the legislature to come back and pass tax packages that would provide that incremental revenue, and which I said if they did that, I'd roll the fare back. And they cursed me, and they hated going back to Albany after July 4th, and they screamed and they yelled, but they passed the tax package, and we rolled back the fare increase. That's not really a direct response, Jonathan, but it wasn't so much a philosophical underpinning. It was sort of a sense of, what's your obligation?
So a practical pragmatist, but with an ethical base and with a larger and good sense of the public interest.
I like to think that, yes.
About politics, you said this. Politics is a species of human relations. You don't stand a chance of having a significant policy impact unless you participate in the political process and establish relationships. What grade would you give Barack Obama?
Not a high one in that regard. Unfortunately, I was a fervent supporter of his both times he ran. I think he's facing enormously difficult challenges. I'm sorry. But I'm going to answer that somewhat indirectly in that Hunter College sponsored a marvelous conference, a retrospective on Lyndon Johnson's presidency. And at the conclusion of that evening, after we heard story after story about how he wheeled and dealed to get the civil rights bills passed that he did, I think it was Bob Schieffer of CBS was the Toastmaster that night, and he got up and he said the lesson to be learned from Lyndon Johnson was that you cannot govern in a democracy without being good at politics. And everybody in that room thought that was a pretty devastating criticism of President Obama. And I think that that is fairly widespread feeling in Washington. And on the other hand, I have to say, in fairness to him, no president confronted the kind of intensely partisan, angry, nasty Republican opposition that he's facing. The Tea Party is a phenomenon. Not because we haven't had third parties or ideological crusades before in American politics, we have. But these are haters. and they have corroded the political process to a degree that is very, very scary, and thus probably have imposed a far greater burden on the challenge of being president than anybody's ever had to face before.
In your memoir, you say, so I became a builder, and everything I later accomplished in my career, public and private, was shaped by the concrete, in both senses, facts of the building business. People may think they have acute insights into politics and public issues, but they don't really understand what shapes civic life unless they know how land is allocated. What do you think about elected chief executives like Obama, but also de Blasio, who've never had a major management job? You talked about your own business career really is essential to what you were able to do in the political sphere.
You know, you look at Harry Truman. Whoever thought Harry Truman was going to be one of the great presidents of the United States? He was viewed as being a backroom politician in Missouri, a political hack, and Roosevelt picked him because there were enough people that didn't want him to pick Henry Wallace again, and almost nobody thought Harry Truman would be a good president. I think history is going to treat Ronald Reagan better than a lot of people, including myself, thought during his presidency, both in terms of what he did in international affairs. And I have to say that the largest infusion of federal money to public transportation in the modern history of the United States came in the Reagan administration. So I don't think you train for job. So much of it is your intuitive sense. I had the great fun and honor of having dinner with George Shultz one night, and he was telling me how Ronald Reagan would say to his secretary, if there was nothing scheduled in the White House at night, to invite a bunch of members of Congress over, come over and have some drinks with him after dinner. And in the course of his years in the White House, he had practically every member of Congress over and sat around, no agenda, off the record, chatting, and he developed a personal relationship with a large number of those relationships to get things done. I may not have liked everything he got done, but he got them done. I tell you, I thought Adlai Stevenson was a hero of mine. He was intellectual, he shared all of my ideals. As I read history and I think back, Eisenhower was a hell of a lot better a president. I thought, and there was recently a retrospective that I would first said.
Sorry about the mic. Can people hear okay? No?
Sorry, I'll talk louder.
Yeah, that's much better. Well, you've done a lot of rescue missions, UDC, but you were also central in trying to avoid the disaster that was coming up on New York in the mid-70s. You tell us that a key moment leading to the 1975 fiscal crisis here happened 10 years earlier when Mayor Wagner got Governor Rockefeller to change the state law on short-term borrowing. Tell us the story, and looking back on the New York City fiscal crisis, how would you assess the responsibility for that crisis? And were there key moments in which a leader could have made better choices and avoided that crisis?
Well, I referred to it earlier, I think, in my beginning remarks, when I said that the city of New York almost went bankrupt because it had borrowed to cover its deficits. Nobody questioned that. First of all, the city's budget was not in the shape that it is now. And the numbers were almost unknown and hard. It was hard to get your arms around the data. two former budget directors sitting here who had a lot to do with straightening it out. I'm flattered that you're here. But it was very, very important. So there was an absence of knowledge. Second of all, there was no realistic expectation that politicians would understand the financial and fiscal complexity of the choices they had. So if their staff said, well, you know, we'll issue more RANs and TANs, and then you don't have to tax and you don't have to cut any essential programs, it was fine. And this occurred, remember, during a period where there were fundamental demographic changes going on in New York. The migration from the South, from Puerto Rico, the doubling of the number of public employees, the loss of a lot of private jobs occurring at the same time as they were moving South and in some cases beginning to move to Asia. So New York was going through a fundamental shift. Nobody in the financial world, nobody in the political world ever even thought to ask the questions, nor did any journalist, and I don't say that critically, because if nobody else was going to ask the question, you could hardly expect a journalist to look behind what was happening and to raise these issues. So there is no rectitude associated with it. But there is rectitude, as I said earlier, as to why people don't recognize the practices that almost put us into bankruptcy, because they're replicating them today all over the country.
You've known and worked with, and mentioned tonight, several governors, Rockefeller, Kerry, Patterson, the Cuomos, and mayors. How would you compare them, and who was best overall, and who was the most importantly, who was financially the most savvy? Who really could you sit down and talk to? And
Hugh Kerry was by far. I think his family had a business background. I'm not sure why he was, but he understood there was some pretty complex financial and legal issues that we had to deal with during the UDC crisis and the city crisis, and he understood them. And so did Ed Koch in his own way. And if I may, I'll just tell you another great story. When the banks refused to lend the money to enable the Urban Development Corporation to finish the construction of 20-odd thousand units of affordable housing, we said to, they said that we had to pay $100 million note that was due a couple of weeks later. And we said, we'll pay the state will appropriate the money to pay the note if you lend them hundreds of millions of dollars that are necessary to complete the housing. And the banks said no. And I said to the governor, we said that we wouldn't pay it. Are you still prepared to call their bluff? He said, absolutely. We didn't pay the note. And it was the first time an instrumentality of the state had defaulted on an obligation to pay a note. The next day, the banks responded by setting off against all of UDC's bank accounts. That is, they grabbed all the money. So UDC had no cash with which to make payroll. And that happened on a Friday. And I called the governor and I said, I think we have to be ready to file a bankruptcy petition. And I had a very distinguished bankruptcy lawyer draw up such a petition. And I said, Governor, I think what we ought to do is invite all the banks to come to your office on Sunday and they ought to see the bankruptcy petition and then decide. And he never said it's a great idea or it's a dumb idea, but he didn't say no. And as the next day progressed, it was a Saturday, I suddenly had this terrible feeling that I was assuming a level of responsibility that I wasn't sure I had the qualification to assume. And I called him on the phone and I said, can we have a drink? And I met him at, there was a crummy restaurant right next to 21 called Roses. And I met him for a drink at Rose's restaurant, and I said, Governor, I said, you're making a fateful decision tomorrow. I think perhaps you're going to get somebody with a little more white hair than I have into this decision process, because we're taking a big risk. And he said, I'll never forget this. He said, I made my bet on you, and I'm sticking with it. And the next day, the banks came to his office, and I remember the CEOs, I won't mention names, of all of our famous investment banks and commercial banks, and did they blink? They saw that bankruptcy petition. They withdrew the set off first thing on Monday morning. The governor went to the legislature and said, appropriate $100 million so we can continue the construction. The legislature not only appropriated it within an hour, but they wrote into the bill that not one penny of that appropriation could be used to pay debt. And then I won't bore you with the details, but eventually John McGillicuddy, the head of Manihani, was put in charge of the bank negotiating team, and within a few weeks we had a solution.
You want the names, they're in here. Two more questions, then we open it up. I have about 100 questions, but I'm going to just do two. Let's fast forward. You're in Albany. You had a grand office in the state capitol, and you said it was a metaphor for the job, elaborate and empty. You went on to say, but I had no portfolio, no duties, no one in state government to whom I had to report or who had to report to me. In that sense, the 18 months I spent in the lieutenant governor's office was the most professionally frustrating period of my life. So looking back, there must have been something you did in that period that gave you some satisfaction.
I did, Jonathan.
And knowing what you now know, would you do it over again?
Well, I did say in the book, I did not do nothing. I decided that it was very important to try to understand whether there was a budgeting system that would avoid the kinds of problems that I saw coming down the line. And through the good graces of some foundations, I was able to raise the money to hire some very talented professional people. One of them, my friend Carol O'Clerican, is sitting here to assist me in this. And we produced a recommended set of changes in the budget process for the state of New York, which I regret to say were not impressive to the political powers that be, let me put it that way. And they went nowhere, but there was a great deal of interest in it. There was a great deal of interest in it all around the country. I remember a wonderful piece Alair Townsend wrote in Queens about the proposal. And people at the Federal Reserve and the Treasury and got interested, and all of that ultimately morphed into an enterprise again with which Carol was associated with me, in which we examined whether the practices were happening in other states around the country. That led to the creation of, with my friend Paul Volcker of the Volcker-Ravitch Task Force on State Fiscal Stress. So in that sense, it was productive.
So the title of the book is So Much to Do. With so much to do, why in the world would you agree to be the advisor to the federal bankruptcy judge in Detroit? And what do you expect to learn from that?
Well, I could give you a smart aleck comment and say there's a degree of masochism in all of us. I guess because I've gotten so fascinated with the problem, that is the most egregious example of irresponsibility by people in politics and people in finance and people in unions, the abuse of the pension system, which put 23,000 retirees and their families in jeopardy that have no Social Security, of having no money in which to live, $18 billion of debt, almost 100,000 creditors, and it was intellectually an enormous challenge, a publicly useful thing to do, and because I do speak out on this subject and do talk to people on the Hill and at Treasury and at the Fed, I'm hope that the solution that ultimately happens there will provide a significant lever to get the President and the Congress to begin to look at this whole problem more seriously, not by writing checks, but by forcing states to budget in a rational and sensible, accrual method rather than a cash method.
They're lucky to have you, and now we're going to open up to your questions. Just a couple requests. Please tell us who you are, make it a question, and keep it short. We'll start with Byron Ween up here.
Okay, well, that's who I am.
Well, that's your name.
I'm Byron Ween. I work for Blackstone. Dick, you're optimistic about the future of governance, and I'm baffled as to why. I mean, the vetting process discourages a lot of very qualified people. The cost of running for even a minor office is very high, and if you don't have personal wealth, the things you have to promise to the people who provide the money can compromise your performance in the job. In addition to that, public service jobs don't pay much, and the cost of living, particularly in New York State, is not cheap. So I wonder why you can be as optimistic about the outlook. I realize there are a lot of idealistic people out there. I was certainly one of them, and along the way you get very discouraged.
Well, Byron, though you've been in the private sector, your intellect and your voice have made a real contribution to the public dialogue, and you've probably had more of an impact than you realize. I'm an optimist because I do not believe that the American democracy is going to fall apart because of this issue, and because there's an increasing interest in the journalistic profession and in academia. As this issue becomes more and more visible, more and more people are interested in it and are recognizing it. So I think a friend of mine who was a Democrat in the House proposed an amendment on the floor of the House the other day to require the Congressional Budget Office to analyze the impact on state governments of federal budget changes. The Republicans happened to vote it down, but it's going to come up again, and people are going to begin to take it more and more seriously. And I find that I had a note the other day from an assemblyman who's chairman of the Committee on Cities of the New York State Assembly. I never met him, he wasn't around. I don't even know whether he was in the assembly when I was lieutenant governor, but I never met him. He called to see if he could come see me, and he said, we have to find other solutions to the problems that we have because most of the cities in New York City is sui generis, but all the upstate cities are in terrible trouble. They have state mandates that they can't afford. They have physical infrastructure that is deteriorating and no money. So all of this, and the state solved the problem by permitting them to make their contributions to their pension system in the form of promissory notes, which is just another form of borrowing. And so there's a whole generation of younger politicians trying to figure out what to do, and the pressures are going to force, hopefully, a change, because the alternative is, at least for those jurisdictions that constitutionally and statutorily can do it, they have to file bankruptcy, which is an acknowledgement. And this is why Hugh Carey was so passionate about avoiding bankruptcy, because he saw it as an acknowledgement that democracy couldn't solve its problems.
So next question, in the back.
Hi, my name is Judy Langer. My question is, you were talking about balanced budget, and I wonder if you could be a little more specific about what would you cut to get there? And part of that question is, people sometimes talk about almost like a generational battle between, do we give the young or do we cut back, you know, but entitlements for the old. So where would you actually cut back?
Well, your question subsumes that I think the only way to deal with deficits is by cutting. There's another way, it's called taxing. And my own predispositions on this reflect my own political values, which don't necessarily make sense. But what I do believe is that the extent to which the problem is solved by cuts or by more revenue, that that's what the political process has to resolve. They can't duck it. So whether I think we ought to cut this program or that program, I mean, I'd cut the bike lanes first before I'd cut anything else. But I...
going to keep the carriage horses, though?
I'd certainly keep the carriage horses. But... you know, I have to tell you, look, I'm a bloody capitalist. I've made my money as a businessman, and I don't like to pay taxes any more than the next person. But I have to tell you, I used to pay a hell of a lot. When I was a young businessman and starting out in New York in the construction business, the marginal tax rate was over 80%. That didn't diminish my greed one iota. And the tax rate today is substantially less than that.
Yeah.
I'm not advocating an 85% tax rate, but I am advocating that we can't ignore the fact that we are going to have to re-examine the entire tax system in the United States.
I have a question here.
Yes.
Yeah, well, here's the mic.
Mr. Ravitch, I find you to be a very fascinating person, and when you're sometimes interviewed on New York One, I always listen. But the question I would like to ask you, do you think that some of the problems that President Obama faces, when you take a senator like Mitch McConnell and Paul Ryan, that some of it is not ideological, but racial?
I tell you very honestly, I've thought about that a lot. And I am... without attributing it to any particular person, I think a lot about whether or not some of the way he's treated doesn't have some racial foundation to it. Yeah, I worry about that a lot. And it's something I think I'm very sensitive to, having participated in the march in Washington in 1963. Civil rights movement has always been an important part of my life, so I'm very sensitive about that. I hope we're both wrong.
Didn't you build the first integrated housing in of the district?
Yes, I did.
Yeah.
1961.
Yeah. This gentleman over here on the side.
You're coming to watch. Hi, my name is Brian Howold. Question is, after the George Washington Bridge scandal, there have been calls for the Port Authority to be disbanded or for PATH to be handed over to New Jersey Transit. I'd like to know your thoughts on these ideas and on the high level of direct influence that each state's governors have on the operation of public agencies, especially transit.
Well,
good question.
Port Authority was created because the harbor froze in 1917. And food and coal could not come to New York or Long Island. And they realized they had to have another method other than barge to bring those necessities across the harbor. And the Port Authority was, as a bi-state agency, had to be created by the Congress of the United States. And I'm pleased to report to you all today, it hasn't yet been in the newspapers, that Senator Schumer has suggested that he is quite willing to get legislation done, or try to get legislation done, to redefine the Port Authority's jurisdiction so that it is the builder and owner of bi-state transportation facilities, which is what it was intended to be, and not be a piggy bank for two governors. And that's what I believe should happen. And I regret the fact that these authorities have been politicized. I recently spent a morning going to the MTA when I heard that they were going to voluntarily lower the tolls on the Verrazano Bridge. And I went and I told the board that they were breaching their fiduciary obligation to reduce their revenues when in fact they were telling the labor unions they were negotiating with they had no ability to pay. And when they are about $20 billion short of what they're going to need in their next five-year capital plan. I'm afraid I had absolutely no impact whatsoever because I have no clout and the governor has a lot of clout. And they voted that way anyway. But I think if somebody wanted to bring a lawsuit, that'd be a very interesting question about their potential vulnerability.
We'll take two more questions in the back.
Good evening, Robert Shanley, Upper West Side. I've always considered you Mr. Fix-It, the go-to man for New York crises, going all the way back to the financial crisis, right up to your tenure as lieutenant governor. My question is, with all the strong advice you might have given in the past, has there ever been advice not heeded, and how frustrating was that?
A lot of it wasn't heeded, and it was frustrating. And in some cases, I was wrong. Steve, I am a layerhead.
Right, they'll get a chance upstairs. Yeah. Yeah.
Mr. Ravitch, yes. If young people are the future, and I think they are, what would you think might be the solution to the growing cost of education, which I think is so important? And my other question is, what do you do about the growing disparity between the wealthy and the middle class and the working class, which I think is also a problem that could bring us with people marching down Main Street? Thank you.
Well, I think the growing disparity in the distribution of wealth in this country is increasingly, I just bought Mr. Piketty's book. I can't say I've read it yet, 500 somewhat turgid looking pages, but I'm certainly interested in reading about it. There's a wonderful columnist in the New York Times, Eduardo Porter, who writes about this subject with considerable distinction. And I think the answer is we have to address our tax system. There are a lot of Americans who don't pay any taxes. That's not right. And there are a lot of Americans who don't pay enough taxes. And there's a lot of politicians who give tax credits to people who don't need tax credits to engage in the economic activity that those tax credits are presumably intended to encourage. So that's how you address that problem. As far as education is concerned, I mean, that, as you well know, is a whole subject unto itself, and I pretend to have no particular expertise at it, but I do think that early childhood education is key. I think that given the number, you know, 20-odd percent of the kids in the public school system in this city are growing up in poverty, and that is not separate, and those are not the kids in the charter schools. I think that we have to re-examine, and I must say I'm not sure how Mayor de Blasio is going to come out on a lot of other issues, but I think his head's on straight on that one.
I'm going to ask the last question. Cindy, you might want to come down. You conclude your book by saying, I've been labeled a builder, a banker, a lawyer, a politician, and a guy who can't make up his mind about what he wants to do when he grows up. This diversity of experiences, along with many kinds of people it has brought into my life, has added immeasurably to the good I've been able to do and the fun I've had.
Now, there have been moments when I've had pangs of envy toward people who knew exactly what they wanted to do, pursued their goal consistently, and achieved great recognition of a single talent. There's been so much serendipity in so many of my choices that there's no way of knowing how things might have turned out otherwise. So my question, there's some Hunter students here and they will see it on rebroadcast. What advice do you give to our Hunter public policy students about career planning? Don't plan and let serendipity prevail? What do you tell them?
No, I don't think, I was suggesting that people don't think about what they're going to do tomorrow. But I would advise them that if they do have an interest in public service, that they certainly begin their careers there first, and that what they think about as they may make changes, in addition to family considerations, that they think very hard of making sure that every professional experience they have opens up new vistas for them, teaches them more about the greater community in which they live. My first job was on the Hill in Washington, and I learned more from a relatively short term there about the United States than I could ever learn. And I realized my cut growing up in New York City is a very parochial experience. And I didn't really know anything about the United States until all of a sudden I was working for a lot of congressmen from parts of the country I'd never been in who spoke in profound accents that I couldn't understand. And so any experience adds to your learning curve. But if you have any instinct about public service, you got to start there. And it doesn't preclude you from making a different decision at some point in your career. But if you read biography much of people who are successful in public service, whether elective politics or serving as appointees, you will find that there is no pattern whatsoever. They come from the business world, the academic world, the union world. If you look at who the real movers and shakers were, some of them were writers. Who was it who wrote about poverty that intrigued Jack Kennedy, and ultimately Harrington, was that his name, who led to the war on poverty? Michael Harrington. And there were proteges of his who started all kinds of wonderful endeavors, Mike Sviridoff at the Ford Foundation. So there were all kinds of institutions in this society that have a very significant opportunity to affect change. And you have to be willing to try them if that's what you want to do. And I'll just conclude by saying that being able to change things for the better is the greatest satisfaction that any human being can ever have.
Well, Roosevelt House is so lucky to have you on the board. You're generous in meeting with our students and giving them a model and inspiration to give back to the world and make it better. So, Dick Ravitch, you've given us a great evening. Thank you very much. There's a book up there. And the book is upstairs, and Dick is going to get up there, I hope, quickly, and sign some copies for you.